one of the things, interestingly, about that, I'm amused but actually disappointed at how many legislators don't talk to certain people. Well, I don't talk to other people, particularly if it's press, but all kinds of, I don't talk to those people. Like, what are you afraid of? Are you afraid they're going to change your mind? Are you afraid that you can't defend your position? What are you afraid of? I go looking for people that don't agree with me. I'm going to learn a lot more from them than I ever will from people that do agree with me. But on the day, my thoughts on the day, I normally don't have high expectations for these little people that people come in to do a presentation, probably because I've heard so many of them. But I thought her comments were incredibly candid and useful to me in two ways. One, all I ever seem to hear is bad news. I'm not doing this, kids are not doing that, teachers are, it's all negative. I get nothing but negative, particularly about what I'm doing, how I'm ruining education. And then I travel to other states and in other countries and I'm thinking, you know, actually we're really doing pretty well. Across the country, we are the envy of the country. Everywhere I travel, it's amazing. And that includes an early education, which I don't think we're doing worth it. I don't think we are scratching the surface on what we need to do in early ed. So that's my big kick, so to speak. And the transformation to the digital environment. The question I didn't get to ask, and I'm going to be looking for while we're here, is how they use technology in the delivery of education. And one of my biggest concerns about us as a country is in teacher prep. I don't believe our teachers are being prepared to use technology. They're prepared to refer to technology, sort of like we're going to jam a textbook into a laptop and now we're in the computer age. Now, I'm a little... Angie Scioli, you know who she is, or Scioli? She's a teacher, very vocal, outspoken teacher in Wake County. I've visited her classroom a couple of times. I'm really impressed with her, but she just wrote an op-ed in the News and Observer a couple of days ago where she threw me under the bus, me in particular. She's visited my classrooms, but I still don't fund textbooks sufficiently. And she and I have had the very discussion about the fact that the moment you hand a child a textbook, it's out of date. As a matter of fact, it's out of date while it's in the warehouse. As a matter of fact, it's out of date when it comes off the printing press. That's why I'm trying to move us to a digital environment. Not to replace teachers, but so that the teachers and the kids have the most current information. But I don't think we know, by and large, there's exceptions and everything. I don't think we, by and large, know how to use technology to teach and for kids to learn. We know how to use it to find an answer. Google that stuff. GTS, we say in the legislature. Have you heard that term, GTS? You know what it means. No, I don't think we're using technology to move the learning part forward. And I don't think, and that's not because we don't want to. We don't know how. It boils down to GTS. Got a question? GTS. You know that term, GTS? I had never heard that term before until about a year and a half ago. It just cracked me up. I thought it was funny. It's like I use it all the time now. I even got my wife using it. So what can I learn? The biggest thing to me today and the rest of this week is to be with you all, to listen to you talk to each other, listen to how you react to things, because as a policymaker, I'm not in the classroom. My job is to create an environment that lets you do your best work. My job is also to hold you accountable for that best work. And that's pretty much it. I create the environment and then get out of your way. I need to fund it to the best of my ability. That is a never-ending enigma. Or as someone once said, a mystery inside a riddle wrapped in, no, enigma inside a riddle wrapped in a mystery. what Churchill said about Russia. Well, that's what the legislative process is, and particularly appropriations. Now, just having come off of months of appropriations, I'm still just a little worked up about it all. On what, even after I do my work and I put forth a budget, then it goes to our full chairs and it goes to the corner offices and it goes to the whole legislature. And by the time it gets back to me and I see, you know, it's like the little kids in telephone. By the time it gets to the end, it doesn't look anything like what you started with. But I'm accountable for it regardless. No matter what it looks like at the end, it's not a matter of what it looks like. From everyone says, Warren, it's your budget. Yeah, it is. Not exactly the one I had planned, but the sign in the store says, you break it, you own it. It's a very frustrating process, and I'm still, I acknowledge that I am gun shy. I don't know if that's the right word. I am touchy about it. I'm working as hard as I know how to work. And people call me and they start off by cursing me and then demanding from me. And I'm thinking, I think that's a good idea. We were talking about down here about incentives. Y'all were talking about incentives. What is that program about?
PBIS.
PBIS, which I had never heard of PBIS before. Mm-hmm. And how PBIS could actually work. And not necessarily, it doesn't have to be, here, I give you something. It can be, you know, you something? That's a really good job today. I'm an old sales guy. I respond really well to incentives. I think most of us respond to incentives, and we know it doesn't, it's not just a tangible object. Money helps. But I've left jobs where I was making a lot of money because the job wasn't for me. Teaching is not a job. Teaching is a calling. I mean, I truly believe that. And I may not have, but I think for a while in our country, and a lot of countries, it was a job. When people needed a job and they couldn't find one, they taught. Mm-hmm. And they taught, they went into teaching with the concept, I'll do this for a couple of years and then I'll move on. You can't do that. You're either wet or you're not.
Yeah, and at the same time, the system needs to support teachers so that it can be sustainable.
Absolutely right.
So that it can be a long-term thing.
Absolutely correct. So, I'm trying to figure out the balance of combination of incentives, rewards, sustainability, motivation. It has a lot to do with policy. But because I make the policy doesn't mean I implement the policy. And I don't want to micromanage education. I don't want to micromanage anything. But lots of things are lost in the translation. By the time it gets off my desk, out of my committee, out of the legislature, signed by the governor, it gets down, and I hate calling it down, I'd probably say up to a teacher. And everybody gets their fingers in it. It's a turducken. Remember that turducken? There's a company that still makes turducken. I've never tasted one. I can't quite imagine one.
How long have you been in the legislature?
This is my fourth term.
Both of my parents were public school teachers. I, you know, grew up, I went to public and private schools in North Carolina, went to the University of North Carolina. Like, teaching is in my blood. It's all I've ever wanted to do. And I was about to quit after my second year, just because it was so hard. And I was in a rural district without very much support, right, other than my coworkers, which luckily I had them. And I came in at the wrong time for everything. So I missed getting tenure by 1 year. I missed master's pay by 1 year. And it was just like, oh my gosh, like everything, this thing I've wanted to do my whole life, and it's just like one thing after another.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
But luckily I really love my school and I love my community. and I'm sticking with it. But I had lots of opinions about it.
Well, and I'm one of the things I'd hope to say to this group, and I hope to say to the group, is first of all, don't be bashful with me. Don't tiptoe around anything. I can't fix a problem I'm not aware of.
Right.
And I can't help you if you don't let me help you.
Mm-hmm.
It's like I tell my constituents, I can't vote the way you want me to vote if you don't talk to me. I can't represent you the way you want to be represented if you don't tell me how that is. And then I have my own internal battle of, am I elected to exercise my best judgment, or am I elected to voice the view of the majority of the people in my district? We are a representative government. I am a representative. So there are always a group, no matter how I vote on anything, there's going to be that group that, well, you don't represent me.
Right.
That's not my opinion.
And I think what we were talking about earlier about whether teachers feel like they're informed about politics or that they have a voice is really important, because I think sometimes teachers are afraid to speak out, especially teachers who do not have tenure, are afraid to speak out in a way that they think is going to be unpopular. And like in my community, it's really, really small, and lots of people are related to each other, and I don't want to be too outspoken,
right,
and then it's like it causes some sort of conflict. So I don't know how to achieve that, of like giving teachers providing a conversation between teachers and policymakers in like a friendly, collaborative environment rather than combative, because I don't think anything gets done in the combative,
right, absolutely,
sort of thing,
because then everybody's on defense,
right, which is not where anybody responds well.
Let's talk about tenure for just a second. Do you believe that, given the scenario you just laid out, do you believe that tenure solves that problem of a teacher that wants to speak up and speak out about an issue or an activity or a policy?
I don't know if I would say it solves a problem, but I'd say that it provides one layer of protection. I agree that people who are not doing their jobs well should not be in the classroom anymore, and there should be a way of being able to fire people who are not doing their jobs well. But without any sort of like due process rights, then you don't have the ability to question why you were fired. And so if someone wanted to retaliate against you personally, I don't feel that way about my administrators or my superintendent. I feel very supported by all of them. But if it was a situation where I didn't feel supported by them, then I would be scared to speak out. I think the other thing tenure does is it provides some stability. So, for example, I'm on a one-year contract always. And I moved back to my hometown. My husband and I bought property. We built a house. And that is the only public high school in the county. So like if I don't get hired there, I'm driving at least 45 minutes somewhere to work. And so it's kind of scary to take on like financial things like a mortgage without the stability of, oh, I think my job's gonna be here for me. And again, I'm doing it because I feel supported by my school. I feel like I am doing a good job, so I don't think that I'm at risk for being booted out of the classroom. But it just feels like one thing that teaching used to offer people was stability, and that's not there quite as much anymore, which doesn't feel great as a teacher.
I think I understand everything you said. I'm always hesitant to tell anyone I understand, because I'm not you.
Right.
I don't walk in your shoes. I've never been a teacher. All of those things.
Mm-hmm.
I have all of my adult life. No, that's not true, because I spent 8 years in the military. Unless I did something terrible, I wasn't going to get kicked out of the military. But after that, I've always been an at-will employee. And most of my adult life, after the military, I was a commissioned sales guy. The incentive is sell or starve. if I have a bad day, I don't bring home any money. Too bad. If I go on vacation, I'm not making any money. Too bad. If I switch jobs, there's a learning curve. So I turned all those things into positives for me. They all worked out. I was scared to death. I do appreciate, I think maybe is the better term rather than understand, the apprehension that a person has without that stability. That I won't call it a guarantee because there are no guarantees. There are no guarantees.
But stability.
By the same token, people that almost everyone is impacted by personalities. Even with tenure, if you're a principal or chairman of the Board of Education or a couple of other teachers, they can make your life miserable. Tenure or no tenure, you're going to quit and say, I'm not dealing with this anymore. I'm sick of it. So it's your ability to deliver results for the administration, the students, all of that. That's your tenure, if you will. Because you can take your profession and you and your husband decide, it's too cold in the mountains, I'm moving to the beach. And you've got a profession that you can take with you. Not everyone has that, because there are certain things that they only happen to you. If you're a furniture maker and you don't live in High Point, the odds are, if you move out of High Point, you're not going to have a job, because you're a furniture maker and they don't make furniture pretty much anywhere else. The tenure thing, like the union thing, has been, we've got a whole lot of people that have been had their heads beat in with tenure, as well as the misuse of labor unions, which started off, I thought they were important and contributory. I don't believe that anymore. But I understand, no, that's the wrong word. I don't understand, I've not been there. I appreciate the challenges that maybe are there now, although I don't necessarily agree that they're there to any less of an extent. Now, let me go back to something we talked about earlier when we talked about teacher prep and teachers, and that bad teachers need to go. There are people in the teaching profession that shouldn't be in the teaching profession. I think every teacher agrees with that. None of them thinks it's them. You said you believe you do a good job. I would suggest to you that every teacher believes they do a good job. Maybe there may be a small minority, a very small minority, that actually knows they're not doing so well. But not many of those.
Right, so I think it goes back to teacher preparation to begin with, but then also like supporting teachers so they can constantly be improving. And part of that, I think, is accountability at the school level of an administrator. Say, like, administration, first of all, they should know what's happening in the classrooms. And if they know, then they should be addressing it with each teacher. A lot of times what happens is there's like a school-wide policy because of something a couple people are doing,
that kind of thing.
But, you know, if you have someone who's willing to say, I've noticed that when I'm in your classroom, this, it happens, I would like to help you work through it. If somebody's really trying hard and they have the support, most likely they will be able to work through it. But I feel like sometimes it's like, oh, you have your teaching license, you're good to go now. Yeah. Take it away, which is not great.
I used the term this past year about professionalizing the teaching profession. And as soon as it came out of my mouth, I was sorry I said it. But the reality is I'm really not sorry I said it. I think that I don't think I use the right words, but what I'm talking about is something you just said. I believe that every professional, regardless of what profession you're in, every profession wants to improve their ability to perform. That's inherent in being a professional. If you're a professional waiter, ditch digger, truck cart, truck driver, you want to improve your ability to perform. I think that may be even particularly true with those in the academic arena, because they realize the more you learn, the more there is to learn. It's sort of like poking your head into a small hole in the ground and seeing a massive cavern. And then you start following that, and then the caverns just get bigger. And there's more to learn, more to see, more to do. So how do we help you do that?
Well, I think the tricky thing about education is that there's no easy way to measure performance.
That's exactly
right. I think all of us know that test scores only tell you so much, but since they're the easiest thing to measure, they get used disproportionately, I think. And I think then you also come up with the issue of how do you account for every student's individual situation? So, you know, in a room of 20, you have 20 stories that who knows what's happening at home or wherever. And sometimes you know that and sometimes you don't. But that's all going to impact everything that happens in that classroom.
Yeah.
And so it's so dynamic and so hard to measure that I think that the model from the business world of like incentives and that kind of thing don't really translate that well to education, because it's not a business. It's different than that. And it's not like I can say, I mean, I guess I could, but it's not like I would say, like, oh, I am not able to perform with this group of students. I'm going to go teach kids who are easier to teach, which happens anyways without a financial incentive. And I think that that's where the like pay for performance gets really, really tricky. And I think that for education to be successful, it needs to be very collaborative. And so if you are competing with your coworkers for anything, I think that's bad. I'm lucky to be in a department that's very collaborative with, you know, lab supplies, teaching resources, everything. Like, we eat lunch together every day that we don't have some sort of duty to do. We hang out outside of school because we like each other and we all get along. And I would hate to see some sort of financial incentive introduced into that, because I think as soon as you do that, I think even something as small as like the AP bonus has the potential to do that. The number of kids passing the AP test.
Mm-hmm.
Because then who teaches the AP classes? And is it better to have the same person teaching it all the time so that they're really learning and it's consistent, they're building every year with what the kids are doing? Or is it better to be fair to the teachers and bounce that class around so that everyone has an equal shot at the bonus, but the kids probably wouldn't do as well? So I think it introduces a dynamic that I personally don't want, because I think it needs to be a collaborative environment versus a competitive environment. So I'm not sure how to account for the like reward good teachers, reward good teaching maybe should be the thing to say, versus also encourage professional collaboration.
The idea of APIB bonuses and some of the other bonuses came out of another state that wasn't an original North Carolina idea. The legislator that pushed that concept, he and I have had this very conversation on several occasions. In fact, just within the last 5 days, we've had this conversation.
And I teach an AP class, so for me, it was like, oh, sweet, now I get a tiny bit of extra money. My classes are small, that's why I say a tiny bit of extra money. But it doesn't change a single thing that I'm doing. I am going to teach the best that I can teach, no matter what.
Well, I think that's inherent in professionals. Like, you always want, you know, whether it's right. In sports or teaching or any profession, the true professionals always want to play at the top of their game. They want to play at the top of their game.
Right, and I guess my experience of teachers that were in my teacher training program and that are my colleagues is that's how everyone is. And I know that must not be the case across the board, but I sometimes feel like the narrative about teachers and teaching is that they're like, there's all this dead weight, and I haven't experienced it as a teacher.
Right.
And I barely experienced it as a student. So I don't know, it's just kind of hard to kind of have a narrative that I just don't see it, in my situation at least.
And I can understand that. There, I did it again. I said I understand. I can appreciate that. But I also can't deny the data that came out of Florida, where APIB bonuses significantly increased the number of kids passing APIB courses. It wasn't a small percentage increase, it was a substantial increase. Why do you think that happened?
Because they started teaching to the test. Especially with AP, it is very clear what's going to be on the test. Not like test questions, but you teach the curriculum, you teach your kids how to do AP essays, that's a skill in its own. Like, my kids could know all the content and not do well on an essay because they don't know how to write it. So I teach them how to write it because that's part of AP. I feel like I need to teach them that. But I think that if you see test scores transform that much because of a financial incentive, it's because people are teaching to the test. And I think teaching to a curriculum and teaching to a test are different things. So like I teach 10th grade biology and I teach the AP biology. And in my 10th grade biology classes, I teach the curriculum, I teach the standards. And I don't have time to teach other stuff that's not in the standards, but I teach the standards and it's biology. But I do not do test prep in my class because I don't think that that's not what I'm there for. I'm teaching them science.
I agree with you.
And on that test, my kids do well on the EOC because they know the content. But that isn't how AP works. You have to teach them how to take the test. You have to do both. So I think that makes it easier to bump those scores up.
But it wasn't happening before. It happened after the incentives were put in place.
So I think some teachers feel restricted by the AP structure and say, I think I know what my kids need more, so I'm going to spend my time doing more labs versus, or whatever, doing more something rather than teaching them how to take the test. And for me, I've chosen to teach them how to take the test in my AP class because I think that's part of the deal that I have with them, right? They're taking the class because they want college credit. And they work really, really hard in that class. And it would be unfair of me to not prepare them for that test. That would be like me not holding up my end of the job, I feel like. And so I choose to teach them that. But if I was, if I had an opinion like, well, this is not what intro college biology should be, it's not what it was when I was in college, that kind of thing, then you could prioritize other things. I teach AP bio in one semester in the spring, and in the mountains that's very short because it snows a lot. Most schools do it in a whole year. And so I think the fact that I can do it in a semester and my kids can do well on it shows that it's possible to crunch it down and teach AP bio, but is it equivalent to Bio 101 at UNC Chapel Hill? No, because they're not getting as much lab. I mean, they have to get a certain amount of lab for AP, but they're not getting as much as they should. But that's like kind of like the game of AP, if you ask me. Like, that's what it is. So I think that adding more incentives like that to other tests incentivizes the teachers to prepare kids for the test, which does not always equal teaching them the content or teaching them all these other skills that we were talking about today, because it's very hard to create a test that measures those skills and therefore they're not prioritized on the tests. So like for the biology EOC, for example, if you are a really good reader and know like some biology, you can do well on that test. And so when I look at my kids' scores, after knowing the kids for a semester, some of it correlates with how well do they know biology, but a lot of it correlates with what are their reading skills. And so I'm trying to teach them collaboration and critical thinking, but that's never gonna show up on those EOC scores, ever. It's just important, so I teach it.
You commented that the teachers with whom you're associated, the administrators with whom you're associated, they're all equally as motivated, playing at the top of their game. And that's what's kept you in where doing what you're doing.
When my department specifically, because right. Our school is kind of like segmented like that.
Just how do you imagine that works out statewide?
Oh, I know it's not the same everywhere because I did student teaching elsewhere. And my dad was in the career for 25 years. So I know that that's not the same everywhere, and that's where I think it goes back to teacher preparation. And I think that I would not be the teacher that I am today, not even close, if it wasn't for one professor at UNC Chapel Hill who ran the teacher preparation program that I was in. And so I think that having the very best educators in charge of teacher preparation, people that really inspire you to want to be the best teacher ever, but also set you up for realism. My professor told me, she's like, I know all of you, you're perfectionists. Years 1 through 3, you're going to be really disappointed with yourself every day. But don't be too hard on yourself, because you're going to quit if you're too hard. She said by year five, you'll start to feel like, oh, I actually know what I'm doing. And in year 7 or 8, you're going to hit your stride. And so being set up for that kind of mentality from the beginning, she was completely right. And it did not necessarily make those first years easier, but it made me realize, like, okay, I just have to stick with it and get better at it. And so I think having people like that in charge of training teachers and having teachers actually go through training is super important. And I understand the issues with like teacher shortages and needing to get more people in easier, but it's just like, I feel like it's kind of a band-aid solution. You need to like train people, high quality people with great training, and then support them, because it's a really hard job. I thought coming out of college, I was like, oh, I know what I'm getting into. I was raised by teachers. I hung out in schools all the time. Like, I've got this, you know? And I cried every day of my first year of teaching. And part of it was because I was just like, there's no way I can be good enough at this. There's just no way. And so without colleagues that were like, yep, we've all been there, keep working at it, here's all my resources, without that, I could not have kept going. Even though I thought, like, oh, I'm good at this, you know? That's probably just like part of being really young and naive. But
anyways, well, some of it is being young and naive. I found sometimes as a sales guy, I hired a lot of salespeople over the years. I found that by hiring a new salesperson and giving them a really tough account that no one had been able to sell, they went in there not knowing that no one had been able to sell them, and they sold them.
Yeah.
But then again, a lot of them came back with their tail between their legs, and it'd be short while and they were gone, because the steam was taken right out of their sails from the very beginning. And you can only take no for so long, and then you just say, you know what, this is not for me, I gotta move on.
Right. And I think one thing my dad has said to me over and over again is that as a teacher, you never know your impact until 15 or 30 years down the road. And as his kid, I have been able to witness adults who have children coming up to him and saying, they called him Crunchly. Not his name, but they'd be like, Crunchly, I remember when you did this and this and this when I was 14. And so even though I teach, you know, teenagers who are not always super thankful for all the hard work their teachers put in, I have now been teaching long enough that I have a few come back and say, like, your class really prepared me for this college class, or I decided to major in biology because of you. But like in your day-to-day grind, you're not getting any sort of reward like that. You're not getting, you know, you might have a supportive faculty around you or administrators, but you're probably not going to get that kind of feedback from your students who you spend all day with. And so I think one of the things that makes it a hard job is that that's the kind of feedback you're getting from your students, which is not always great, and then to not feel supported by the state sometimes, or feel like no matter what you do, it's not good enough, can like just make it even harder, a hard job even harder. I think that goes back to like the collaborative environment between policymakers and teachers rather than a combative one.
There, I certainly don't deny that there is a combative relationship. It didn't happen overnight either.
No.
We have a tendency to look to blame somebody or something for all of our ills and difficulties. But the only way we're going to get out of this and get back on track, if and whatever on track means. Teaching has always been difficult, so that's why I'm not sure what on track means. 100 years ago, teachers were happy to get a chicken and a place to sleep to be able to teach the kids, or teach kids.
Yeah. One thing I've also thought of, this is kind of going on a completely different tangent, but teaching started off primarily as a female profession, in a time when women usually worked up until the point they had children and then stopped working.
Right.
And there's been a teacher in every generation of my family for several generations, so like I've seen that history in my family. But now, teachers, still, I guess probably mostly predominantly women, I would guess still. High school not as much, but other grades. But now we're in a society where we have two earners in the household usually. And the women aren't working for a few years, it's like a career. And I think sometimes the respect hasn't totally changed into like, this is a profession that people do. These are highly trained people. And necessarily the compensation hasn't changed to that, like, you know. And it was interesting today, our conversation about physical labor versus not. My husband is an arborist, and so he climbs trees with chainsaws all day, and I could never do his job ever. And I'm a teacher, and he's like, I could never do your job ever either. But I've gone through all of this school that I use in my job every day, and I paid for that school. And he's working with his hands, and he's able to make way more money than I am, which is great for us. You know, I'm thankful for that. But I feel like sometimes the professionalism is not there in terms of like how we're compensated either. And I know that I could take my degrees and go to a different profession to make more money, but I want to live in the mountains of North Carolina and I want to teach kids, so I'm not going to do that.
But hasn't it,
kind of weird.
And this is not meant to be an excuse at all, but hasn't it really been that way almost forever? That teaching, you never made much money. If you needed,
yeah, I agree.
A spouse had to make. I remember when I was in school, a lot of kids quit at 16. They turned 16, they quit and went to work in a factory. I grew up in a small Midwest town. They went to work for John Deere. I remember coming out for football practice one night, and there was a kid that had dropped out of school about a year before, who had stopped in to just harass us all. He and the coach got to talking, and he pulled out his pay stub. And did you hear me tell the story earlier? Pulled out his pay stub, and the teacher about went nuts.
Yeah.
The guy was making considerably, a kid that had dropped out of high school at 16 was making considerably more than an experienced veteran teacher who also coached football.
Right, you know, I totally agree that it has been going on forever, but I'm saying that.
But that's no excuse.
And it should.
And I'm not trying to hide behind that at all.
And I think,
well,
too,
like.
Go ahead.
Well, I want to go back to teacher preparation just for a minute, because this is. There are some things I can control and a whole lot of things I can't. I'm as much as I'm concerned about early ed, which I pretty much top of the fold for me, I believe I'm equally as concerned about teacher prep, because what I'm seeing is I get out in more and more schools, especially schools that are showing some incredible turnarounds. I was in a school in Milan, Salisbury, that has 93% free and reduced, 94, 95, somewhere in the mid-90s free and reduced. A school that 3 years ago had this, by the way, an elementary school, had over 200 out-of-school suspensions. Just 2 years ago. This year, they had 4. So what changed? New principal, new environment, some new teachers, not a lot of them, some new teachers. The one-to-one approach. So I asked the principal, I need a little more meat on the bones and one-to-one approach and a new principal. So I'm really curious, when you hire teachers, and now teachers sometimes never meet the principal until the day they walk in because they're hired over the internet. There might be a Skype interview, fill out a bunch of forms, teacher shows up. I said, are the teachers coming to you prepared to enter your classroom? Oh, no, no. He said, no. We take first-year teachers come in July, and we work with them pretty hard into their third year. So my question then is, if our teachers aren't coming to you prepared to teach, then we need to make some adjustments in our teacher preparation program so that it doesn't all have to be here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I don't see us doing that in our teacher preparation program, whether they be here in North Carolina or actually almost anywhere else. I don't think our teacher preparation programs are keeping up with the demand of the marketplace, if you will, considering the kids are the marketplace.
Are you familiar with the UNC Best program on Chapel Hill? That's the baccalaureate education in science teaching?
It rings a bell, but I can't say I'm familiar with it. I've been working with the new dean of the School of Education, Fouad, I can't remember his last name, couldn't pronounce it anyway. And matter of fact, I'm pressing him pretty hard, as I am all of our schools. We have the majority of our teachers come out of 3 or 4 schools, and then the percentage of teachers drop off pretty quickly after those 3 or 4 schools that the teachers come out of. UNC Greensboro, UNC Charlotte, App, mm-hmm. and I think Wilmington. I think those are the 4 that dominate our teacher prep, or the teacher prep programs that most of our teachers run. We still get quite a few from independent colleges. We get them out of state, etc. The challenge has been that we're such a rapidly growing state that we need adults in the classroom. And we haven't necessarily gone after our best and brightest because we need somebody to get in that classroom.
So the UNC Best program is the program that I went through, and it's specifically geared at science and math.
Okay.
So it's trying to get highly qualified people who have a degree in science or math to also get certified to teach. So it's all during undergrad. So I graduated with a degree in biology and my teaching license. And it's really awesome. If you have the chance to go visit and talk with Dr. Coble, is the professor for the biology stuff.
S-O-B-O-R?
Coble.
C-O-B-L-E. Coble. I thought you said Sobor. I don't know why.
Jennifer Coble. So what happened was that my sophomore year or junior year, I had a class with her that I think it was my junior year, which included an internship at a school where it was just observation. So once a week I would go observe at a school. And then one of our classes was teaching methods in biology. So it was 100% focused on biology. How do you teach this stuff that our kids need to know? And so there's the same thing for geology, for earth science, there's math, all that kind of stuff, physics. And then my senior year, my last semester of college, I was a student teacher at a school in Research Triangle Park. And that was my whole academic load, was being a student teacher. And every semester I was in the program, we also had a seminar, which was like one night a week, and we would all get together. So the people who were student teaching already were then interacting with the people who were going to do it the next year. And there was just a lot of collaboration about how to face every single challenge, from classroom management to how do you do systems in your classroom, how do you teach this one specific content. And then after I graduated, every summer there's a retreat for the alumni to come back to Chapel Hill and do sharing. And I didn't go this year because it was last weekend and I was about to come here. But it's the thing that made a huge difference, I think, for me in that program was a personal connection with a professor who was really supportive and really knew her stuff, and then an ongoing support. So I live in this isolated district. There's one and a half other biology teachers, but I have the opportunity to collaborate with a group of people I know and have worked with from all over the state. And even sometimes she just sends out an email to all the alumni like, "Hi, I hope you're having a good school year." And just to know that like that person who taught me all this stuff is still checking up on me is great. But the program itself is outlined so that it's really specific, focused in the content, and very minimum requirements in the school of ed. So, you know, we had to take a class about teaching students with special needs and, you know, a couple other classes like that, ESL kind of classes. But the primary focus was on how do you teach this content to kids in a way that's engaging for them and that they understand it? And I really don't know what my teaching would look like if I hadn't gone through that program, obviously, but I use strategies every day that I learned in that class. Whereas some of my coworkers were lateral entry, so it meant their first years, they were also taking classes at night and the closest university is an hour away. And so it just kind of like stretches them thin. So I feel like what they have going on with the UNC BEST program is a really cool model, at least for secondary, mm-hmm. like, you know, 9 through 12, because it's so focused on content. But I just can't really imagine trying to go into the profession without adequate training. It just seems like a nightmare.
Well, the new Teaching Fellows program, mm-hmm. which focuses on STEM, I think will buttress that, maybe bring more attention to it so we can spread those successes out to other college prep or teacher prep programs. I would hope so. Mm-hmm. Kind of the idea, let's learn, see what
we
can learn.
Why did Teaching Fellows go away?
The primary reason was money. When I came into office in 2011, the state was $3 billion overspent. We couldn't borrow any money. We had the highest tax rate in the Southeast, one among the highest in the nation. Our bond rating was faltering. And unemployment was 14, 15, as much as 18% in some jurisdictions. We had no money in the bank as a state. It was a fiscal disaster, a result of lots of things. Certainly the longest, deepest recession, huge contributor, but we were losing our fundamental industries, our employment base, furniture, textiles, tobacco, all leaving the state. We had to make major changes immediately. My approach was on everything that came across the desk, so to speak, in appropriation, I had one question on every item. What am I getting for what I'm paying? I had to be able to justify to those taxpayers that were paying the highest taxes in the Southeast, here's what you're getting for what you're paying. If I couldn't come up with a good answer, when I had three or four competing programs and I can only afford one, which one's giving me the most results? That's what I'm gonna have to do. It's not that these others are doing poorly or I don't like them. I've gotta put what money I have to its best use. And Teaching Fellows, like master's pay, fell off the table. Not that I don't agree with them. I had very limited funds, and we needed to do something. We had to do it now. We can't. So let's stick with this another year. Another year, the state could have gone bankrupt. I didn't come here to put the state into bankruptcy. So we made some hard, perhaps unwise decisions, but they're ones that had to be made. I've had to do that in my own life, as a matter of fact, as many of us have. When someone loses their job. But now we've turned that corner. We are now one of the lowest tax states in the Southeast, one and among the lowest in the nation. We've got over $2 billion in the bank for that quote rainy day fund, which is for the first time in almost this history in North Carolina, we have met our constitutional obligation in that area. We talk about constitutional obligations in lots of areas, including education, that we've never met, and that was one of them. We'd never met that one either. So lots of bad decisions, or difficult decisions. As much as education took it on the chin, just as public safety took it even more so. And we're still not doing anything near what just fundamentally needs to be done in that area. So those are the reasons lots of things went away.
Do you see a connection between those cuts and not being able to recruit teachers?
Well, you could it would seem that way, but interestingly, the teacher enrollment is down some 20% in North Carolina. We have several states across the country where it's down 50%.
Did they have similar kinds of cuts?
No. They didn't lose industries like we lost entire industries.
But did they cut things
yes. Cuts were everywhere. During the recession, as I said, longest, deepest in American history other than the Great Depression.
Seems like maybe that's, it may be true in North Carolina and those other states, that's the reason. Yeah.
I'm not suggesting at all it was unique to North Carolina or what we did was unique to North Carolina. We tried to learn from others as well, right. So let's not make their mistakes. They're terribly difficult decisions that I didn't want to participate in, but Representative Horn, how do you vote? Yes or no? Okay. Now we're in the process of putting Humpty Dumpty back together again. Perhaps we can as well, while we're doing that, let's learn from all of those pieces and parts that maybe some of them weren't as good as we thought. Maybe there are new better ways to attack, approach, resolve issues, and even some of the issues aren't the same today as they were even 5 or 6 years ago.
So do you view master's pay as one of those things that you think there's a better solution to?
When we cut master's pay, that was one in particular where there was no data to show improved student outcomes from when a teacher got their master's. No data. In fact is, we had a rather, quote, world-famous Duke University report that showed that buttressed that argument, that there's no improvement in student. Now, that didn't seem right to me. I voted to cut it because I didn't have any money, and no one could show me what I was getting for what I'm paying. So 2 years ago, I went back and said, I need another study because I don't agree with the. It just doesn't seem logical to me, especially when we talk about the fact that subject matter expertise is one of the critical indicators of improved teaching, or improved teaching outcomes. So Duke came out with another study that showed exactly what the first study said.
I've heard of studies where that's true, except for in high school science and math.
Well, it's interesting that the second study did come out and indicate, it didn't make the statement, but they indicated that probably in the STEM disciplines, that may, it didn't say isn't true, but may not be true. And I support that. Now, I'm going to say something that's self-serving, but not intended to be, in that I propose that we restore masters for STEM subjects, STEM teachers. Thought I might be able to get that through the legislature. Well, I didn't. My fault. I was not able to get it in the final budget.
So, but I remember
that we're still working on it. Just to let you know, that ship hasn't sailed yet. It's just, I haven't gotten it off.
Very slow.
I'm sorry, because I interrupted you.
Oh, no, it's okay.
Well, there are a number of things that I think we need to address in rewarding. Well, let's start with attracting,
right.
And then retaining high-quality teachers, and motivating them as well.
I remember when master's pay was first cut, it was also going to be phased out for people who already had it.
Correct.
When does that end? Wasn't it supposed to be like 2018, but that's
right. We,
in the middle of the budget.
In the first, when we cut it originally, all we left in were the people that were currently in the master's program. Mm-hmm. And then we revised that to those that had applied for the master's program but hadn't yet begun it. So first there was, we're not paying masters. Then, well, we'll pay masters to people that have had it. We'll grandfather them in. And then, well, we will, if you're in the master's program, we're going to let you now finish it and be paid. So that's where we are presently.
And so those people will have it indefinitely.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. It seems logical that the more you know about a subject, the better student outcomes you can produce. Because you're
able, it's definitely part of the puzzle, but it's not
the whole
thing. But I feel like in my case, I'm teaching a college level biology class. It makes sense that I should have a degree higher than an undergrad.
No argument whatsoever.
And so, I chose to enroll in it knowing that I wasn't going to get paid more. I paid for it. I still wanted to do it because I wanted the content knowledge.
So that's a sign of a professional. That's a sign of a a personal commitment.
Nice.
It's no, it's not. I don't disagree with you at all. Of course, it would be nice. In my own company, and I was a sales oriented company, but I knew that the more my salespeople knew, the more knowledge they had, the better chances I had of them actually getting the sale and keeping it. Mm-hmm. Because they understood much more about the product, the industry, the customer. They had a greater depth of understanding. I think that same is true with a teacher. You gain depth of understanding. You gain a certain amount of contentment in that you know. It's going to be pretty hard for them because I learned this. I know this stuff. I know this stuff pretty darn well. So you have a certain level of self-confidence that people know right away. They know when, just like you know when your kids are making it up as they go, they know when the teacher's making it up as she goes.
Yeah, I remember that as a student.
Yeah.
And I think too, it helps, for me at least, I can see how it helps all of the kinds of learners that I'm teaching. So it helps the kids who are struggling because I know the content forward and backward, and so I know how to make it more accessible to them. So I know how to simplify it, I know how to understand.
Do you think those are the same skills?
They are for me. So for example, I was taught, you know, in high school, in AP Bio, and in college, cellular respiration and photosynthesis, these two processes that happen. Okay, sure. And it was not until I went through my teaching methods class and then learned even more in my master's class of like, oh, that's how these things are applicable to everyday life. And I had to understand them in great detail in order to be able to apply them. And so for one group of students, that means I can teach you how to apply this. And for another group of students, I can teach them, this is how you apply this, but check out all this cool chemistry too. Mm-hmm. And they don't need to know that in their lives, but it piques their curiosity. And the kids who are really into science, or even kids who just need to know details in order to understand something, they're not happy with an incomplete picture, they want to know the whole thing. I've had a few students like that. I can say, like, stick around for a few minutes at lunch, I want to tell you more about this. Or like, everyone else, don't get confused in the next 3 minutes. Okay, listen, this is what I'm talking about, and it helps them know the whole picture. So I think I've definitely interacted with people who are highly educated, and I feel like they're just talking straight over my head. So I know that can happen. But I also feel like if you really know your content and you know how to teach, those two things together,
that's the magic
clearly
potion.
Have a better
impact. That's a substantial piece of part of the magic potion. And I say part because they also have to come in ready.
Right.
Which goes back to the collaborative, as well as my favorite word in education is scaffolding. Mm-hmm. Scaffolding. And each level has to carry its weight so that you can move on to the next level.
Right.
And you can't move on to the next level if you don't have a good foundation prior. So, which is the argument against rewards for student success, if you will. That's the argument against it. It's a logical reward, sort of. Because there's so much data, again, and you probably are right. I'm not gonna yet agree with you that incentives work when you teach to the test and rather than teach the subject matter. I don't know that there's enough data yet to either argue that point or sustain the point.
I think it's also hard to measure that though, because like, who's going to say yes, I teach to the test?
Right.
No one, because that's not a popular thing.
Well,
to say.
I believe we need to fundamentally change how we do testing and what's the other word for testing that we use all the time?
Assessment.
Pardon me?
Assessment.
Assessments, exactly right. I ask this question of every teacher. Do assessments have to be tests? And of course not. You assess your class beginning the day you walk in, and you may have never seen some of these kids before in your life.
Yeah, and you assess them constantly. That's
exactly right. You can constantly reassess them. So one of the things I think the digital environment's going to allow us to do is to use testing as a teaching tool, not just as a measuring stick. And let me give you an example. A friend of mine, Senator Howard Stevenson in Utah, came up with this analogy, which I've embraced. The analogy is, imagine a baseball pitcher who leans in, gets the sign, winds up, throws the ball, And the moment that ball leaves his hands, you put your hands over his eyes. He gets the ball again, he gets the sign, and he throws the ball, and you do the same thing again. You do that the whole game, and next week you give him a piece of paper that shows him how he did. I suggest that with the digital environment, testing now becomes a teaching tool, because the test can be organized in such a manner that that digital environment allows you, the teacher, to note that the child A, got it wrong, or B, hesitated. Secondly, the digital environment allows within re-ask the question 3 or 4 questions later, and maybe turn it around a little bit.
Same content.
But still, did they just not understand? Was it confusing? Are they having a bad day? And next time, bingo, they got it. Okay, they got it. Or this time, they hesitated again. And computers can figure that. So as a consequence, their lesson plan for that child changes. Because they got these other 9 things correct, but they're struggling with this concept. So we're going to change their lesson plan, which may be a whole different issue for student B, C, or D. So the one-to-one approach to education through the digital environment can now begin to address the needs of the individual, so that we emphasize the positive and we remediate the challenges right then and there, instead of, oh, by the way, you got 20 questions wrong on a test last week, and I'm going, let's see, do I remember that test last week? I don't even remember.
So two things. One thing is that, I don't know if you know this or not, but we get basically 0 data from EOC scores. So like my EOC is online. I get 0 feedback on what my kids did well on and what they didn't. All I get is on goal 1, they scored 9% higher than the state average. They should be able to tell me, on this specific standard, this objective, your kids don't understand cell transport. But they do get all these other things that are in that goal. So like, I don't understand why my kids take a test, we get the scores back the same day or the next day, and I get 0 feedback from the state.
See, and that we've got to resolve, and I think we can resolve that fairly. We can resolve that, I think, fairly quickly.
I think it should, yeah.
A lot of it, I will tell you, did I know that? No, I didn't know that.
My principal didn't know that until a couple years ago, and I told them about it.
These are the kinds of things that, now those are places where I can actually get involved and make a change. And I can make it fairly quickly.